So welcome to the Ethereum Berlin Meetup. This is a roughly monthly event happening in the Ethereum offices, which is a great opportunity to meet developers, get direct feedback from smart contract developers to platform developers and vice versa, and also meet cool, interesting people and projects related to blockchains, smart contracts, and Ethereum. Today, Ryan Taylor is offering streaming services, which is really great and was requested by a lot of people already, I guess. And the program for today, we will have, so unfortunately, one of the speakers could not come, but we will have three talks. One of them is about a software called Descartes by Michael, and then another talk by Ethereum's Yann Levreau about our recent progress in the IDE we're developing called Remix. And then we'll have a short break, and after the break, Ligi will talk about esPass, which is a event ticketing system on the blockchain. And after that, we'll have some general Q&A, depending on what you're interested in, perhaps about CK snarks or just any topic you like. Okay, Michael, where are you? Ah, great. So, applause for Michael.
Thank you. Okay. I'm gonna connect it like this here. Oh, thank you. Hello, can you hear me? Hello, hello? 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 Ah, okay. Okay, very good. Okay. Okay, can you see? We can't see anything. How do you turn it on? Okay. It's probably better like this, I believe. Yeah. Okay. Maybe. Okay. Hi guys, nice to meet you. I'm Michael from Decartes AI. So basically, I wanted to show you something amazing we've created for software developer teams. And instead of like telling you very much about, I don't know, what we actually do, I'm going to show you a demo, how we hack with Descartes. Can you see, by the way, can you see something?
No.
Yeah, it's... Okay, so basically we are an artificial intelligence-based platform for software developer teams. You have, on the left side, you have one of your IDEs. We are IDE independent and programming language independent. On the right side, you have Descartes, you have us. You log in with GitHub, and you interact with code. How do you do it? Let me show you. We have two modes currently. You basically double click in one of your editors to learn something about the particular code. For instance, I want to learn about this browser window. I see the currencies. I can go to them directly by clicking here. Instead of, there is no searching, there is no nothing. So what I'm doing is basically browsing code without needing to, I don't know, I can understand it. Like for instance, this variable, what happens to this variable or what happens to this one without really, I don't know, searching anywhere. I can basically click here, learn about this variable. Well, this is used here. I can go there with double clicks. Then we've invented a protocol. This is the URI, so this is based on this protocol. We've invented a protocol which allows us to document this code per line. So for instance, I'm interested in this particular feature here. I can comment it. Like I can say, okay, I want to comment this line, or I want to comment this file, like in Facebook pretty much. Like me, I'm gonna comment it, send, I'm gonna have a notification. Then if I go to another file, click here, I'm not seeing anything. I'm not seeing those comments. When I get back here, I see them again. Like here, you can see them here, related to this particular file. What we're doing is we try to help developers to interact with code independently of programming languages, independently of OSs, and independently of IDEs. And right now we're working on issuing a token. This is why I'm here. So we want to allow developers to like interact freely and create this flow between developers so that they can get rewarded properly. And there is this interaction between them. As you can see currently, we've made this experience of, I don't know, a combination of Slack, Google Inbox, and Trello for code. As I said, like a browser here. It's pretty much like a browser. And what we want to have developers here with Deckard working pretty much with a machine. So this machine would be pretty much helping them understanding problems, understanding developers, profiling developers. They'd be interacting with code like you see me interacting here. So with double clicks, there's gonna be much less searching, and there's gonna be much, like for instance, let me show you what we already have. We can learn from the entire internet. We have a Slack bot which learns from Wikipedia, from Stack Overflow, like 20 million questions, from GitHub repositories, from commits, pull requests, etc. We show them. We show them with faces, which pretty much means that we try to get them from somewhere and really make programming this social experience. Then what we're doing is we log all developers there working with Deckard. So basically, instead of three developers on a software team, you now have three developers and Deckard, the machine. So eventually, like our bigger vision is machines writing code. It's a difficult problem and it's currently not solved. So nobody has been able to solve it, like really machines writing code. But we are going in that direction. And we want to issue token to enable better interaction between those developers. So we want to be able to reward developers, and we want to be able to, basically to reward developers in a proper way. And I just came here to ask you questions. Maybe you guys have some ideas, what we could do, what is interesting, any feedback, stuff like that. Yeah, I'm pretty much done.
How do you read the line numbers and the text below the curve?
Exactly. So we've invented a protocol, which we call it the decode protocol, which exploits invariants in files, which allows you to, for instance, if a file changes, like in the repos, we can still catch understand the lines. How do we do it? We basically understand from your Git repository all the changes, all the lines, the entire code, we understand it. And we basically associate it, we create addresses, like virtual addresses for code. This is what we do. And then we associate those addresses, we connect them with IDEs. So we've created a layer, like an abstraction layer for all IDEs. Like for instance, let me show you one example. I'm now gonna open something from Microsoft. Visual Studio Code is very nice. Okay, it's Deckard. And now not only it's going to work the decode protocol, not only it's going to work with that editor, Atom, it's going to work simultaneously with both. So I want to learn about space parser, and I have it. It changed. I want to learn if there are comments in this file. I go here, okay, and I see that somebody's been talking about this file, this, you know, this analyzed Python file. So not only does it work for all IDEs, for currently for two OSs, we can, if the file changes dramatically, like this, we're still gonna be able to recover the data and associate this, we have this address for the code. That's still, that works as well.
But did you save the file now before
yes.
the code can
yes.
deal with it?
Yes, exactly. What we're doing in the backend, we are re-indexing everything locally on your machine. That's the thing, that's what we do.
So what happens if I have a repository with a lot of files?
If you have, let me show you an example. I can open Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is a huge repository. That's a very good question. That's a very good question. Now I'm gonna click here. I want to learn about this convert dotted quad to hex, whatever. We're showing that we're currently indexing the files. Now I'm gonna click somewhere else. And there, it's pretty much already done. We're still indexing the file. It's gonna take like 30 seconds, but it's done in parallel on different, it's here locally, but it's done in parallel. You see, we've already been able to recover the faces of people from, I don't know, commits, pull requests, I don't know, discussions somewhere, I don't know, from Wikipedia, et cetera, et cetera. So we can do it. And this is Elasticsearch. This is a huge repo. It took us 30 seconds or 25.
So basically, what you do is you aggregate all kind of comments around that code somewhere on the internet.
We started exactly that. We started by creating a Slack bot that was essentially learning from the entire internet, like took petabytes of data from this place, from this place, from the Wikipedia, from comments, from pull requests, from Stack Overflow questions, etc. So we basically started like this. We've created this bot. That started to learn from code. And from there, we started to learn the product. We created this abstraction layer for IDEs so that you can now, this is quite crazy. So I want to like really emphasize that. You can really work pretty much with every modern IDE with code like this. So with a double click, you can get pretty much all information about the code. And with this navigation feature, of course, we don't have so much time, so I'm not focusing on it right now, but we call it augmentation of working memory. You don't need to memorize so many things. Like, I could show you how I code, but it's kind of a crazy experience, but yeah. It's kind of a crazy experience. And yes, we are right now really working on issuing a token, and I'd be very happy to learn from you what you guys think, how to do it. How to make it properly, how to make it work, what can we do about it?
So what would be the point of the token?
Yeah, exactly. So we want to enable this interaction between developers. So one developer who's so Deckard is capable of profiling developers and understanding the entire environment. So it is capable of knowing that this developer has been very helpful. And we want to be able to reward the helpful developers. That's the thing. We want to be able to reward people who, I don't know, help projects grow fast, stuff like that. This is what we want to achieve.
How?
Yeah, exactly. And this is my question to you, basically. That's my question to you. I want to learn. I just came here to learn something from you, from the community.
Again. You install a plugin for each IDE?
Exactly. So this is what you do. So you basically, you do this. It's very simple. So you basically install a plugin for an IDE. You just download it, and it's like this. And then you basically integrate your GitHub repo, and that's everything you need to do.
Do you also have WebStorm?
Yes, we have IntelliJ, so we have WebStorm, IDEA, PyCharm, etc., etc. So we have all of them. I can show you how it works with them. So there is, for instance, I don't even have it installed. So there is, for instance, WebStorm. Yeah. We also have Sublime. I mean, not in this version, but we also have Sublime. We have Trello integration. We started with Slack integration, but it's not full integration. We're going to have Jira integration.
What do you mean with integration?
By integration, I'm going to show you.
So you add it to the sidebar of
Yeah, so for instance, you can post directly to Trello, for instance, from this discussion. You've been discussing with somebody, and your discussion has been associated, has its code address, this URI that you see here. This is our sort of URI. And you basically discuss with somebody. This discussion has its own code address, and you basically... you can basically post it directly to Trello, or you can post it directly to Jira, or we could do the other way around, like we could get notifications from, say, a pull request, for instance. Okay, and this is an example with WebStorm. So you see, I just downloaded one other repo, and it's still working. So that's the idea. What do you guys think? thank you. But like some criticism, some ideas, I want some feedback. Yeah, very nice to hear that it's awesome.
I mean, the design is a little bit geeky looking.
Yeah, I know, I'm a little bit, geeky myself as well, so it's kind of difficult
for example,
to...
For somebody who doesn't know what it is, looking at it, it looks very confusing. It doesn't look clearly separated.
We're working on the UX. It's gonna be beautiful, like a beautiful girl. But currently, it's like me, more like, yeah.
I was wondering if the results you're getting are in which way they're ordered. Is it chronological?
Yes. Here in the topic section, actually, this topic section is gonna change. We're gonna have like a bunch of filters like this in mobile apps or in Google Inbox, whatever. So here you basically see them grouped by, hashtags. But you can, like for instance here, you have them grouped by, I don't know, time, whatever. So, and you see we use it in production, so it's not like a new app. We've been using it for the last 6 months in production and it works. It's a combination of this, hashtags from Twitter and interaction from Trello. And if you do it like this, it does remind something, right? So this is what we're trying to get.
Does it also contain comments from GitHub?
Yes, comments, pull requests, commits, everything. Yes. And what you can do, you can basically click here, and it opens the right file, and you go there. So it's already, we know the links, we know stuff like
so
that.
It's like what you do is like a Google for code repository.
Some projects like in the US that we know they started with code search, right. This would be more like Google for code repository. What we're more likely to do is this new environment for collaborations with machines, because Deckard, like for instance, it tells you some stuff. Like for instance, when it sees that three developers are working on some project, on a couple of lines of code, but it shouldn't be taking so long. It can tell the senior developer who developed the app in first place, okay, if you help the guys or refactor the code, you're gonna save 10,000 euros for the company, stuff like that. So we want to introduce, it looks like that, but we want to introduce a real machine working with software developers. And in order to achieve it, we need to bridge the current software development, which is super scattered, unstructured, poor, with some sort of better structuring tools, and this is what we're doing, like this invariance that we're introducing using the decode protocol allows us to create those virtual addresses for code. And as I said, when the code changes, they still work. We can share those addresses via Slack. We have integrations in browsers. So you can basically post a link like that and it's gonna work in the browser. So currently, actually not if you download the actual version right now, not, but we test it like all the time and it works. On ours, we just need to.
How fast do you index? For example, if there's a new issue coming up in GitHub related to my project, I'm
pretty much instant, pretty much instant.
But you watch the whole internet instantly.
We as I said, we started by creating a huge bot that learned from the entire internet. And right now, when I opened the Elasticsearch repo, it took us like 25 seconds here. Elasticsearch is pretty big. And we index.
But it checks also immediately GitHub, all related.
It checks everything that it needs. Exactly, pretty much all the time. It's just done in a tricky way so that it doesn't do everything all the time. So for instance.
You do it on your servers. So it is like a centralized service.
This is exactly one of the things that is also interesting to me. Currently, it is done on our servers, and this indexing here is done on this machine. That's the thing. So we have a version that does it on-premise for companies, but we also, this version here is doing the entire indexing locally. That's the thing. We can do it on this machine.
So you upload this then to your central server, which then includes it into the larger index.
Yes.
If I would like manipulate the software just to fool your system?
If you want to hack something in the software, you can try to hack something in the software. I mean, we're hackers as well, you know. It's there's gonna be some crazy experiences, right? I mean, we have to learn. We're very happy to learn. you had some question, right?
It's already been answered.
Okay, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, for helping or for rewarding grateful coders, like I think you could implement something like a minting mechanism that is more like, you know, like proof of participation. Minting tokens in accordance with progress that coders achieve.
Exactly that.
You want to sell these tokens like an ICO.
Yes, we thought of ICO, exactly. Yeah. Exactly that.
It has to have a value, right?
Yeah, exactly.
How can you sell something?
Yeah, exactly that. And the value that we're currently considering is this value of knowledge of software developers and software developers teams sharing this information. We also have been thinking about reusing this project information for other teams. This is yet something else. So we could potentially have like this token to enable two different software developer teams to communicate with each other, like between the teams, not only within the teams. But this is yet another idea. We don't have it yet.
The question is, how do you justify the initial generation of tokens? Yeah. If this is representing time people invested into building something, coding, or knowledge, like how do you justify like a...
Exactly.
Exactly.
So knowledge, you can pretty much measure. I mean, there are very many metrics when it comes to software development, right? So knowledge, you can pretty much measure. The same for time. It's just a matter of like really learning together with you from your experiences what really works, what doesn't work, etc. I mean, we've been reading about it for quite a while. We understand the ICOs, right? It's just that.
So from my perspective, the difficult thing is giving value to the token, right?
Yeah.
The people buy in ICOs because they think, like, I can buy this now cheap and this will be a lot cheaper.
Yes.
It's a really simple math here.
Yeah.
The token has to fulfill that.
Yeah.
If it's just like a token, then people realize after a while, like, oh, but there is actually no value behind it.
It doesn't
make any sense.
Yeah.
Then that's a scam, right?
Definitely. So just learning together with you what makes sense, what doesn't make sense, etc. So you see what we're doing. We're basically learning and profiling software developers. Mm-hmm. We believe in the vision of machines working on software developer teams. And we believe that this is one of the most important visions. If you look at Elon Musk, what he says about this, like this is what is going to be the biggest thing that happened in human history. And what OpenAI says about this, that desk to code is one of their projects that they listed on their site officially, and say that this is one of the most important problems in artificial intelligence in the history, and the most difficult one as well. So we're basically learning all the time. This is one of the reasons I'm not only here to present the app, I'm also here to meet the people, to talk to them, to understand a bit more. That's the thing.
What is the timeline for release? So this is now an alpha version?
This is already a beta version. We have the first clients. We have 350 developers, 40 actively using the app. We have we closed two rounds of funding. We started from Axel Springer here in Germany, and we closed with the first investor. And right now we are,
So the app is free to download?
The app is free to download, exactly that.
Do you make money out of a special indexing service? For?
Currently, we're just giving simple. So the app is free for open source companies, and we charge pretty much like GitLab and the other companies, so we are super cheap because we want organic growth. So we want to go to developers and tell them, okay, guys, we're really going to boost you. It's going to be pretty much free. Well, our value is to go to the entire world and tell them that this is the way to do software development. That's the thing. So this is why we're not charging that much right now. Yeah, and the rest is me basically coming here to learn a bit as well. Do you guys have any questions, some feedback? I'd be happy to hear some, well, this is amazing or something like more, or maybe this is crap.
What happened to the bot?
The bot is still there. The Slack bot is still there. It's working. You can ask him. I need to check if I can actually test it now. Code with Deckard. Let me see. Oh, it looks like this pretty much. I can show you. So, for instance, go connect to Postgres, and it tells you connection string is something like this. Oh, for instance. Okay, I don't have very many messages because we must have deleted them for some reason, but it looks pretty much like this. So you basically ask a question, it already has the data from the internet, and it gives you the answer using machine learning algorithms, stuff like that. This is the bot. We've been to San Francisco to talk to the Slack guys, so we are gonna proceed with the Slack integration. Currently, the next version is gonna have the Trello integration. For now.
GitHub.
So for now, that's one of the options. I'm actually in the in Gitter, Ethereum project Gitter. I'm there. I just read. I'm not talking much, but I'm reading. But for now, we don't have any ideas regarding Gitter.
Okay. Now we use in Ethereum.
I know that. I know that.
And it's pretty useful.
Yeah, definitely.
It's more open than Slack because Slack needs the invite.
Makes a lot of sense. For us, if the community likes it, we can create it, definitely. For us, it's not a lot of, we need a lot of integrations, interesting integrations, definitely, definitely. Why not? If you guys want it, we can create it for you.
A simple question.
Yeah.
The spelling of your company name?
It's DECKARD.AI. Deckard AI. Deckard is from, what is the name? Who knows? Who's Deckard? Blade Runner. By the way, I didn't know it myself. So that's kind of lame, but I didn't know it myself. Yeah, it's from Blade Runner. Exactly. Do you guys have any other questions? Okay, then thank you. Thank you. back from the secret room.
As you like.
Okay.
Computer here. As you like, yeah.
Okay. Hi guys. Sorry. Here, right?
Okay, so today I'm welcoming Yann to talk about the IDE remix.
Hi. So I made a short demo 2 months ago on remix, and it was on the early stage of the development. And now we have reached a level that we can consider that we could now develop contract and use remix now to redevelop and use and create contracts. So I will just, I think, give another demo, which will be, I guess, more interesting than the other one. And so, yeah. So this talk is mostly about developing contracts. I mean the back end of the Ethereum environment. If I will just give a bit of overview, that
this is a bit weird.
Sorry?
Yeah, could you sit on the table?
Yeah, so if we just give a bit of overview of our works those last months. So we have started 1 year ago to work on Mix. It was the first IDE. It was developed using Qt and C++. It was a bit hard to maintain and it was very complicated to use. So we have just scratched everything and we started from scratch. And that's Remix. At the same time, there were another application. The name was Browser Solidity. It was some kind of editor for Solidity. And then now, last week, we have just merged Remix, which was the debugger tool for Ethereum, and Browser Solidity, which was the IDE. So we merged those two applications into one. That's Remix, the IDE. And then, so we are still developing that stuff, and we have a few months now to work before we can release the first version. But I think now we can say that you can use it to develop contracts. And the purpose of my talk will be also to try to give a first sound about how to process the contract development and how to reach a finality where you can really streamline development. I mean, starting to work from the back-end side to the front-end side. And yeah, so this is the most, this is the purpose of my talk, to talk about a good way to organize and to streamline development. So first, when you want to develop contracts, you want to have a really quick and easy feedback on your development. You don't want to spend time to try to debug. You just want to see if the code does what you want to do. And you don't want to have a node. You don't want to have a Go client node. You don't want to have this. You just want to have your browser, and you want to develop things, and you want to test things easily. So that's my first demo. Can you... The screen is a bit... All right, thanks. Cool. So that's a remix. By the way, if I would just ask, anybody of you has already heard about remix and... Yeah, cool. So this is a remix.
Just to check. Good. Or not good, but that will change soon.
Yeah. So that's remix. That's the IDE for Ethereum. In the left side, like this side, you have the Solidity editor and you can write contract. And in this side, you have like the compilation result. So for example, here I have a contract, the name is donation. And each time I'm writing this contract, I have the compilation results of the contract in the right side here. So I can just start now to take a look at it. And as I'm writing the contract, I can test it. For example, I can create. Here, ah, wait, I have to change something. Something that I should say before. So you have this panel here, which will describe. Sorry. Okay. So you have this panel here. This panel will describe where Remix will be connected to. In this option, we will just use Remix in the browser, and everything will run in the browser. So each time we will create a transaction, each time we will send something, everything will run in the browser. So if, for example, I reload the page, I will lose everything, right? And those two options here are used in case you used Remix using Mist or MetaMask or using another node. So if you have a Go node elsewhere, and if you want your Remix to be connected to this node, you will have to choose Web3 provider here, and you will have to fill in with the address of the node. So for now, I want to stay in the browser, and I will just select JavaScript VM here, and I can start just to create the contract here. And that's the point. So I am developing the contract, and at the same time I am developing the contract, I can test it, and I can debug it as well. And that's kind of really important. So you don't lose time to have a complex architecture to test things. You can already test it in the browser right now. So let's say that I will call one function of this contract. So one important thing is that as the contract is deployed in the blockchain here, in the fake blockchain, I can call those functions here. So if I click on fallback, I will call the fallback function here. If I click on move font here, I will call this function. So I can try to use it, and I will call the fallback function here, right? And then you see there is two icons here that allows me to debug the contract. So I can click here, and then at this point, I can just go over, you can see here the source location of the execution. I can go over every steps of the execution, and I can check how the transaction behaves. And I can check the execution of transaction. And at the same time, I can also see the states. So here I have some states, here some state variables in this contract. The first one is owner, here, this is address type. I have a giver here, this is an array of address, and I have values here, an array of uints. So I can just check out here the execution of my contract here, and I can verify if the transaction is fine, and I can just check out if everything is okay. So I can go here and I can check changes on the states here. So that's something that was kind of missing before, and we add this in Mix actually. But having this stuff in the browser, I think it's very nice because you can use it now. You can just browse remix.ethereum.org and you can start develop contracts. And so you can check out changes on the states here. You see that the owner, the address of the owner is here. You can see that now I have one giver here and you have the address of the giver, which is the same actually. And I have also the values here. Right? So that's first step. I can also check out this function, move font here. And I will, sorry, but I will just copy and paste something. I have to. wait.
What I always do in these situations is I create a simple function that returns msg.sender.
Yeah.
So the problem is that you have some accounts with fixed addresses which are basically pre-generated for this IDE, and we don't have a nice way to use these addresses as input of functions yet.
So I have checked the fallback function, it's nice. Now I will just call this function, move from. So I will stop debugging here, it's okay. And I will click here. So I have one error here, and I can just debug it here. So I have a warning here that says that I have an error in this transaction. And I can do the same, I can just go over
still send some ether with the call.
Yeah, but I think.
Yeah.
Sorry?
You send some ether with the call, I think, and it conflicts with a non-payable.
Oh, okay, sorry. Right. Yeah. How will we do it? Okay. Right. Okay, right. And now, so I can, what I want to show is that in the first case, I was able to see the changes on the state. And now I can do the same. I can go over the execution of the code, but I can also check out local variables here. So here I have just two variables, balance and amount here. And I can check out what the code is doing. So now I am checking for the balance. Now I am checking if the send is successful or not, etc. But there is, wait. Okay, and if I do that. Okay. Now, what I am doing now, I am recalling move fun here, but with this value here. And I don't have any value. So I still have an error here, and I can still debug it to check what is the problem. And are we just, yes, right. So I can just click on the warning here, and I will just be jumped in the location where the exception is. So in that case, I know that I have an exception because I don't have enough balance here. So just to resume a bit my sound, you can check out and see changes on local variables here. You can see changes on the states. That's very nice. And you can also here jump where an exception has been thrown. And that's the two main features that we have developed those 2 months, like. Okay, so that's first things. Now I have my contract, and I know that it's okay. I can debug it, cool. But now I want to develop the front-end side. I want just to be able to see if this contract will work well, if I will write a bit of JavaScript with that. So I will, I have just to make a parenthesis. What is kind of missing now in this IDE is kind of a testing framework. So to have tests and so on, we will add this, I think, in the future. But now we don't have this. So I usually recommend to use Embark or Truffle. They are also a good framework, testing frameworks. And you can use it together with Remix if you want to have a consistent environment. So that's the things. So I think the backend is cool, but when you want to deal with the front end, it's a bit harder. I mean, for me, it was very hard. So I write contracts, it's cool, and then I want to write the front end, but I don't know really how to plug my contract with the front end side, and I don't know really how it works, or, I mean, there is no such application that allows to write contract and to write the front end at the same time. So it's not complicated, but it's kind of hard sometimes. So I will just propose one solution, which is not the nicest solution for now, but I guess we can improve it in the future. So first, what you need to do if you want to write the front end, you want to get out of the browser. So you want to have a node, actually. So first things, we will have to run a node, which will run in a test mode. So for here, oh, it's really, I cannot, can you see it? Barely not, okay. Can we increase the font size of the,
I don't see. Probably not. I guess the actual command doesn't matter too much, right?
Yeah, so, okay, I will just, okay. So what I want to show you here is the command line to start the Go client and the command line to start the CPP client in test mode and in test mode as well. When I say test mode, it's just that the node will run in a kind of private node. So the node will run in your computer and nobody will be able to access it. So I have the option dash dash dev for the Go client, and I have the option dash dash tests for the CPP client. And so parameters are a bit different, but they do the same thing. They allow you to have a private node, a private test node. Okay. If you look at the CPP client, there is one more thing that you have, is some functions that can be used if you use CPP client. For example, mind blocks. So as you are calling web3.eth.account or web3.eth.getBalance, for example, you can also call web3.test.mineBlocks if you are in test mode, obviously. And it's pretty nice because you can choose the number of blocks that you want to mine. So let's say that you have a test, a really huge test, and in your test you have to mine 1,000 blocks, but you don't want to wait 1 day or you don't want to wait 1 hour to mine blocks. So you just write web3.eth.mineBlocks, you will write 1,000, and then the client will just mine 1,000 blocks. So I think it makes sense for some tests to be able to mine a lot of blocks. So you have set chain params, mine blocks, as I said, modify timestamp, add blocks, which is pretty the same, and rewind to block. This is also cool. So if you are if you have a test and if you have reached a block, you can just rewind to another block to rerun the test in a different mode or with different inputs or I don't know what. So it's kind of also interesting to deal with those options. Okay. So now I have my node, which is I have to find it. Okay, it's here. It's on the left side. It's a Go node, which run in a test mode. Okay, and on this side, I just have a random HTTP server, which hosts my front end. Okay. So I need now to to write my front end side. So I have two solutions. The first will be to use Mist. This is the Ethereum client, and Mist is just an application that you can use to manage your wallet and to browse Ethereum application. You can also use MetaMask. Now I will use MetaMask because it was kind of quicker for me, but Mist will work as well. So MetaMask is here. It's kind of a Chrome plugin. You can just install it, and you can just select the node where you want to connect to. So if I click here, I will be connected to the main chain, and if I click here, I will be connected to my node, the node that is in my computer. So I will just stay like this. It's fine. I reject. Okay. Okay, and I will do a quick resume now. So I have Remix here. I can set up Remix to run here, as you see, to be connected to my local node. So everything is fine and the contract should be fine. There is not so much bug now because I already tested with the JavaScript VM. And here I have my front-end side with MetaMask or Mist. And I have my node here, which is kind of a bridge between Remix and the front end. It's not so like that, but it can be seen like that. So I have three stuff. And now I can check out how to do things. So I will just create this contract here. Wait, I should. Oh yeah, and also I should start to mine. If I don't mine, it will not work. Yeah, because I have to mine, obviously. if I don't mine any transaction, no transaction will be mined at all. So I will have to wait a bit. Okay, it's fine. So I have my community here at this address. I will zoom a bit if I can. Okay, so I have this community here, and the code of the community is just here also. So I will just copy and paste this address in my front end. So this is kind of manual things. You don't have to do like this, but it was easier for me to do that. Okay. Right, and now I can just call wallet. Yeah. Just remember, I have my wallet, my community here, and I have this function here, create wallet. So this stuff will just create a new wallet, and will register the wallet into my community. So this create wallet here action will just call this function here using MetaMask as a bridge and going through the Go node. Okay, so he's complaining. I will say accept. And I have to wait also. Okay, so now it should be okay. I will just click on request refill. This is another function here which is in the wallet code. Okay, I can see that everything is nice because the value has been updated here. And so what I want to show you now is that I am just writing my front end. It's nice, okay? And because I already worked on my contract here, I don't have huge bugs. I have some bugs, but I don't have huge bugs. But I can have bugs. So what I want to be able to do is to debug stuff that are executed here. So if I look here, I have logged some stuff. And I am logging in the bottom here every transaction that happens in the network. So I will just copy and paste the last one, transaction hash. I will just copy and paste this transaction. I think it's request refill, it's this one. And I will check if I can debug it from here. Okay. So it seems that I still have some issue because I have a warning here. But I am still able to debug it. So that's I think the main stuff that I want to show you now is that now you can write contract easily using Remix and the JavaScript VM here. But if you want to write, and when you will have to write the front-end side of your contract, you can still use Remix to debug code. Because I mean, you will need and you will have, and it's very interesting, and it's kind of mandatory to be able to debug everything and everywhere. So this is the last feature that we have added. This debug stuff, and we hope to add some other features soon. And the next one will be, I think, to make a Remix a bit more a real IDE, because this is an IDE, but it lacks some features. It lacks some project management features, and we have to improve it. Yeah. So I think I am done. if you want to use Remix, you can just browse remix.ethereum.org. If you want to contribute, or if you want to ask questions, or if you want anything, you can just check out those Gitter channel here. And also, if you want to contribute to Remix, don't hesitate, and yeah, we will be happy to talk to you all. Thanks. If you have questions, you can.
The debugger is highlighting small pieces of code. I was expecting maybe something line by line. Can you explain why and what happens there?
Oh yeah, yeah. Just because. Okay. You mean that here?
Yeah. Sometimes just the left side. Sometimes just the right side. Sometimes an entire function.
Yeah, because we are just highlighting source location of. I don't know the exact word in English, but it's. Statements. So we are just we have a source location of statements here, but we don't have the whole line. So we know that for this opcode, it will correspond to this statement, and the statement is just like an assignment like this or a declaration, but it's not a whole line. For example, if you have these things. Okay, you have a lot of stuff in this line. You have many statements. You have one declaration here, one assignment here, and one other declaration here, and one other assignment. So we have a statement of source location, but we don't have the source line. But I guess this is something that we we'll maybe need to change, right?
So it looks like you're stepping through the picture
Yeah, yeah, but this is. Wait, it's not. Where is that?
Yeah.
Okay, so anyway, you have this. We are stepping over the bytecode, okay. Yeah, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, even if you don't step, I mean, I guess if you have complex expression, then sometimes it makes sense to look at the individual elements of the expression.
Definitely.
And then there's also, so it also happens that it highlights the whole function. That is the case when you're currently at pieces of the code which are basically the function header, kind of, so generated by the compiler, which do not correspond to actual parts you've written inside a function.
Do you currently compile on the fly when I write my contract code?
Yeah.
And you show me errors when I mistype something?
Mm-hmm.
Do you do compilation on the fly right now?
Yeah. Yeah. Now, oh yeah, if you write, but you can type it. You can click on auto compile here if you don't want auto compilation.
Okay, cool. I might just for now would switch as to the JavaScript VM as
it is the default.
Oh, okay.
I mean, if you, yeah, sorry, if you are in Mist or MetaMask, the default will be the provider, this one, so given by Mist or MetaMask.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have nothing, it's the VM will be default. Yeah.
Okay,
cool.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Looks for a global Web3.js object. If it's there, it uses it. Otherwise, it uses
the. Yeah, that might change. But yeah, we definitely should add this as a default to Mist.
Hmm. Yeah, so thanks.
Okay, so we'll make a break of about, I don't know, 20 minutes. Have some drinks. Have some prepared perhaps.
How much of the background, all of this is actually how much interface elements you are built and how much is a library? Do you build this as a library so it can be interface
with
things? Yeah. Or do you entangle all layout with the
computer code?
Please welcome Ligi, who will talk about esPass, an Ethereum-based ticketing system.
Welcome back, everyone. Greetings. The first half of this meetup was about development tools, and now we will look at the other side, a bit on the application layer. Before I start, I want to give you some context and some history about this project. First of all, I really love trees. These are magnificent beings, and I don't want that trees end up like this, if at all. A tree should end up like that. So for the 29C3, that's the Chaos Communication Congress 4 years ago, I stumbled upon Passbook for the first time. And I really liked the idea, but there was no Android app really working for me, and there was no free software so that I could just fix my problems. So at this point in time, I started the project from scratch to basically just for me to get into this venue. But this project attracted a lot of users, and over the years creating and maintaining this app, I got some ideas on how we could improve electronic tickets. And now I show you the secret sauce. It's that. The barcode is the most important thing about these passes. And this is where the big change, as you see, will take place. The thing is, before, on the left side, that's password-style authentication, and that's how tickets work today. Basically, these venues have big lists of allowed passwords or UIDs they give out as barcodes. And we can change that, and we can use asymmetric crypto for that. But for the user, it basically looks the same. And that's really important. I will talk about a bit about user experience after the talk. This is not changing is really important. One should not build a crypto system yourself. Like, you should use a well-tested and old crypto system. So an early idea in this project was to use colored coins. I think Andreas will remember we talked about that. He told me that is an option. And I really like Bitcoin for the idea it brought to the world, but I really hate it for the energy consumption. And there is a really nice talk by Jacek at a recent Datengarten last year, where he actually calculated the impact of proof of work, and it's really devastating. Like, it's really a lot. Like, he calculates it in form of coal, and it's really bad. So the video is online on media.ccc.de. Everyone in the crypto space should watch that. It's really bad. But Bitcoin is really good for what it brought to the world. Just like, this is a Bitcoin data center. Like, they are not small. Like, that's really, really huge, and they are burning a lot of energy. We are now here at an Ethereum meetup, so I don't need to advocate for Ethereum, but I want to tell you a little bit what my main motivation is to use Ethereum here. It's really the upgrade path to proof of stake, to Casper, and also I really love the foresight of the difficulty bomb, to do that really early, to not in the end run into works for us, and now all the miners don't want to switch. It's really good that you have a forcing function there. And it's really good that the switch to proof of stake should take place. And also, we get a way more flexible crypto system with that, way more flexible than Bitcoin. And we could solve the core problems I wanted to address also with the colored coins, but we get way more options with Ethereum. We will see that later on. This is a really, really easy smart contract we can use there, and that's why I also don't need to use Remix right now. There is nothing to debug. These are the easiest contracts we can use, token contracts basically, and we can do really, really a lot with that. It should be a bit more extended, and here that's more, that also fits on one slide, because we should be compatible to ERC20 to basically be able to interopt with automatically, like with Raiden or with shops or something like that. There's a lot of like interoperability that is possible with ERC20. We introduce a lot of complexity here. So what basically do we gain? There's one big problem. These are events that have more demand than capacity. There are, for example, two rocket-based, very popular rocket-based events that have this problem regularly. And then you have this problem of, like, for example, trick ticket fraud. If it's like a password-based system and you want to sell your ticket, it's hard from both sides, from the seller and from the buyer, because like the seller, for the buyer, it's like the hardest, because for the buyer, he doesn't know if this ticket is really valid. He cannot really check. He doesn't know if this ticket was sold 100 times, and he's the first one. And only if you're the first one with that ticket at the entrance, you will get in. Otherwise, you're outsider. I was at the gate at the Congress, and there were some people that had this problem, basically buying tickets, and they were already invalid because people were already getting in with that. So by doing that, it's really, really easy to resell tickets. Like, you can use a lot of infrastructure from Ethereum for that. And it gets really, because it's a token on the blockchain, that's the main function to pass this token on. That's the main function, so it's really easy. And that way, it also gets cheaper. Like, for example, here it's really hard to read because red on black, but that's what I did. Here I was buying like 7 tickets for under 100 euros, and I had to pay like 12 euros in fee for like nothing. Like, and you can make it really easy to set up in the end. You can go even further, like, and make it cheaper. You don't need the global consensus. You just need the consensus between you and the venue, basically. And if both sides already have keys, like from, for example, from old events, you can reuse them, and just the venue signs you something with their key that you can gain, get into the venue, and you don't need to extra save something on the blockchain. Another thing you can solve with that is that problem. The thing is, like, if you have an event, it's also for events that have a lot of like demand, and the thing is, if you announce the tickets are not on sale, servers most of the time go down, even if there are really good people behind that. Especially if like not try to get a ticket, it's really hard. And the servers go down, and you cannot really do much against that. The thing I have to note here, we can solve that problem technically really, really easy, but there will still be an ethical problem that's left after solving the technical problem, because at the moment, what would happen if we solve it with a smart contract? The one who pays the highest fee basically gets his ticket. Yeah? When you all hit the same block, then the one who pays the highest fee. So we have to find other ways to do that. But we can solve the bad gateway problem. What you really don't want is that people like that get your tickets and basically just hoard them and try to resell them for a big price. That could really, really ruin the thing. You can easily solve that, and also the problem before, by requiring an identity. When you bind it to an identity, that's, for example, how Fusion is doing it here. You bind it to an identity, but I want to get away from that. Giving away your identity for some of these events is not that good. Another advantage that brings is you can make ticket auctions. And ticket auctions for these cases are really nice for price finding. Because if you make the event too cheap, then basically a lot of people are coming, it's really crowded, and it's maybe not that fun because you cannot move. But if you make it too expensive, nobody comes and you have an empty venue. So ticket auctions could solve that problem and balance that. And you can make members-only events, for example. For example, with a project like Mango, you give the tickets to a conference about a certain project that is hosted with Mango, automatically yield tickets for the conference from your developer account, basically, with these keys. And you can reuse also these keys, because it's not like a password. You can solve multiple challenges with that. For example, one idea is like to switch on and off lights in the venue, or for example, after an hackathon, all participants could vote with their key, like these community votings. You can reuse this key multiple times. Another thing you can do with the key, there was a really, really nice talk by Carsten Noel and a co-host where I can't pronounce the name and I won't do it because I would do it wrong. Please watch the talk, they tell it there. And there's a big problem with travel tickets. Boarding pass, travel tickets, where it's basically also like printed passwords on there and also printed on your luggage where you can access sensible data and even cancel flights and take over air miles, which is really bad. But if you have like public-private key pair, you can solve a lot of these problems. Also, you can use the history. For example, you get a cheaper fare for the ticket the next year after you attended 1 year. You can merge passes. That's really nice when you are in a line waiting and then you say, like, we are a group of five, we combine these tickets, basically combine all these tokens to one account, and then only you have to scan the barcode only once. You can enter way fast. And you can even split up when one says, oh, no, now I want to get some food, I want to leave the group. You can basically transfer this token out. Another thing that is really important to me is the ability of not having to give your name everywhere. At the moment, for like a lot of events, you have to give out your name, and that's a really bad thing. And now we have basically a chance to hide it a little bit. And you can have really, really nice early bird sales. You can make them a little bit like ICOs, like for example here the Ethereum ICO. And that really helps to finance events early and get needed funds early to bootstrap events, basically. And you can make things like you can verify artists and speakers. For example, when someone publishes music distributed on a DApp and signs with his key, you can use that for these events that an artist can also sign the smart contract for some event and says, I'm going there. I'm proving I will attend this event. And the next step for sure for that is then event DAOs, that you basically you can start with a crowdfunding phase for an event. And basically if a lot of enough people ship in money, then the next stage is arrived and money is transferred to the artists and to the venue, securing the venue. And you can make then, we would need Remix and stuff for that, because then the smart contracts get really complex. And you can make really, really interesting stuff with that. But back from exploring what's possible in the future, let's talk about the present again. So where we at the moment? Like the format is now specified and used in PassAndroid, that's my Passbook app, and also via a plugin in Pretix. Pretix is basically the shop system to yield these passes. And since August last year, the MIME type is even registered at the IANA. Fun fact, the Apple format is not in there. And end of last year for the 33C3, esPass was first time used as a format for end users. It was at that time password style. It's just preparing that next year perhaps you could add the blockchain to that. You have both options basically in the format. But we have to do one step after the other, and that's one step. Another thing that's coming now this year is the Light client is getting somewhere, and a big shout out to Felix, I saw him here. Like, we are really getting there, things are moving, and for me, personally, the Light client is really important for that project. I could have started earlier, like with a full node, but I'm coming basically from this user experience. I want that this is usable for users and not for somebody else. And then a full node doesn't make sense. I really need Light clients to have a good user experience there. And yeah. But there are still some problems. Also, perhaps you could look at this issue. Like I have some minor issues with that. Like for example, here the invalid transactions, VSR values. That's a bad bug. I cannot reproduce it. But perhaps if somebody else, huh? Awesome, that sounds good. Yeah, so we can jump over that. So that's really, this year will be nice. Yeah. So then we can talk a bit about UX because user experience is really, really important. We cannot solve the problems we are facing currently, and this world faces a shitload of problems when we just build this new fancy tech just for us nerds. You know, we have to build that for humans, and that's why, let's talk a bit about easy transition and graceful degradation, and that's possible because we cannot dump down these passes at every point in time to basically go back to what we had before. This password style, by just saying the last private public key pair, basically we sign this challenge. It's working basically that way, that at the door you sign a challenge with your the last private key, basically, and then you get access. And you can do that at any point in time and basically make a normal, even PDF pass from it. You can go back to the old style. You lose all the new functionality, but in some cases that might be a good thing. And it's good for the users because if they don't need the new features, they don't have to see any new complexity. And the thing is, we could now build a system and say everyone has to install a light client and stuff, but then nobody would use it. Don't even see that things have changed. Basically, you can see that as skeuomorphism, the barcode. But don't get me wrong, I don't want to stick to barcodes. In the end, it should look like that, but not in the beginning, because we cannot change too much things in the beginning, because then it would not work. So we can have nice IoT thingies there, and I think what's happening here now is even a good preparation for that, because if you already have key pairs, it's easier to integrate that with IoT entrances, or I could even imagine some events where that isn't needed, where you don't have access control, but basically you have a fancy system which measures if over 80% of the people at the venue have paid. It's really easy to do that in a non-privacy aware way, but I want to make it that it's privacy aware by just having cameras and it's measuring and that should be possible. And then you just stop the music if 79% of people just paid, you stop the music. And then you have basically a point, people are incentivized to pay because the event makes no sense when there's no audio. There are a lot of ways in the future. One more thing, because I've seen in the Meetup that here were a lot of event organizers. I don't see them currently, but nevertheless, especially here, we should use open systems. And I've often seen blockchain events, and then you had to click your ticket with Xing or Facebook or Eventim, Meetup, other stuff. I just want to plug here, there's a really nice open source project, Pretix, which you can use for events like that. And there, then you have even, there's this esPass plugin. You have the option to later on use all these features I was telling you about. And there's another really low-hanging fruit for the crypto community here, because what I was doing there is a ticket output plugin for esPass. And another step which could be useful is then writing a payment provider plugin. There are some payment provider plugins, but no Bitcoin or Ethereum yet. And that would be really easy. I'm not a Python or web guy, and I was able to really easily do that in less than half a day. And that should also just query if some account get new funds, and then yield a ticket should be really easy. So I'm coming slowly to the end. Something I want to talk about here. This is a project I'm working currently on because I need to verify these passes. So I need to interact basically with the blockchain. And I don't want to do that in the Passbook app because this app also gets big. And light client sounds really tiny and light, but it's still just in comparison with this big Ethereum thing. It's still a big thing, and I'm reading all these things that it's just syncing in half a second. That's not my in half a minute. 30 seconds was what was going on Reddit. From different experiences, it's faster than normal, but it still can go to 10 minutes, and that's not really a good user experience there. So what I'm basically doing there is on the work of Peter from the Go team. He was presenting the in-process node, which is compiled from the Go client, and I'm using that for an Android app, which then communicates basically with other apps and can do things like verification of tickets. And then from the Passbook app, I'm asking the wallet app if this ticket is valid, and there I can also securely store all my keys and do all the key handling and don't have to spread that over a lot of apps. Yeah, that isn't open yet. It will be open source, but it's really too early for me to publish that because there are some, like you saw this bug before, and it's just crashing, and that's not a good thing. But that's on the right path, and if you're interested in that, also for use cases, for other use cases that could be fulfilled with that, defining the interface currently there, just contact me. I will give contact details in a second. That said, I'm really happy about feedback and use cases. Just approach me, and it's good if you do that early because then I'm not bound to like implementation and specification. There's still a lot of room to change, and I don't want to remove that. Yeah, that's basically it. Thank you for listening. And here are some links to follow up. Like esPass.it is the link to the projects. Ligi.de is my website, my landing page. You can contact me there. Have a nice day, and thank you for listening.